And thanks to all of you for joining us. And I think it's telling, you know, when Sarah and I were trying to figure out, okay, what's the next topic? What are we hearing from Hoyas all across the country and the world? And it just comes back to this elusive concept of, yeah, now I'm a manager, and so what? Like, how do I do this? And I've been known for my work up to now, so what am I going to be known for moving forward when I'm not doing the work anymore, but now it's about how I'm leading people? And there is just so much energy around this topic. So thank you all for taking the time. I think it's indicative. I think no one teaches us this stuff. We just kind of get thrown into it, especially if we're high potential and high performing. We're given other people to shepherd and to take through our organization. So our hope in this series is a couple of things. One is to give you time and space to actually think about this stuff, even for every couple of months, to really just push the pause button and the timeout button and have some time to think about yourself as a manager. What are you doing? What are you not doing? Where are their blind spots? Where are their strengths that you really want to be capitalizing on? So that's kind of our one thing, is selfishly a little bit of time for you. Second is really just to build a toolkit, give you a couple of coaching and communication tips, tricks, best practices that my team and I have seen across industry, across clients, across all levels of organizations when it comes to best management practices. So really, we want to make this rich in content, but also rich in space for you to reflect. And finally, I think just to give you some space to consider, what do I want beyond management? What is my management experience going to look like? And how is that tracking to my professional goals, to what I want next, to some milestones or achievements that you have on your bucket list right now? And we hope to be able to shepherd you to that place as well through this series. So let me tell you a little bit about what we do, so just so you have context of the type of leadership. And for those of you who've joined us in the past, you have a good sense, but this is really the leadership from the inside out. And that's part of, you know, the company and our philosophy, the paradox of leadership, that we can't just give you skills without first talking about what goes on internally for you as a manager. Right? Where do you get stuck? Where is some of your habitual thinking, habitual programming? Where do we need to make some tweaks and change a couple of the lenses to really bring you forward to be your highest and best self? And in doing so, then serving others as a manager, as a leader, however you find yourself. Another important piece of our philosophy is that this is not just impacting you as a manager at work. This is about leadership of your life. Right? This is about integrating your personal life, your professional life, and having you be the best version of you, the strongest and biggest and baddest version of you, to then allow that to transpire and to have a ripple effect on all of the lives that you touch. So that's just a bit about kind of philosophically how we work. In terms of our work itself, it's working across organizations, industry, size, scope, doing all basically leadership development trainings, one-on-one coaching, top team coaching, a lot of assessments, emotional intelligence, really the soft skills of leadership, which then drive to, you know, bottom line, hardline results. So you'll also get a chance to meet some of the coaches on my team, which I'm thrilled about, later on in the series. So I'll tell you a little bit about that at the close, and we invite you to join us for those talks as well. But without further ado, let us get started for today. So as I said, we're not going to be able to talk about management skills before we talk about who you are as a manager, what you want as a manager, how you got here, and what do you want this experience to be like? And this, to me, is sort of the guilty pleasure of of the four sessions that we're going to be doing together, because it really is about mindset. It really is about, hold on a second, pause the button for 1 hour so I can really think about how have I gotten here? What is it that I want to experience out of my time as a manager? What do I want my people to experience? How do I want people to describe me? Right? How do I want people to think about me? Without actually understanding these, we're not going to be able to get a very concrete game plan for the type of manager you want to be tactically and practically each day. So here's what happens. Many of you are finding yourself in a place, right, where you are functionally excellent, high-performing individual contributors, right? after Georgetown, you went on, you did great things, you know, you milestones, achievements, maybe you went on, got a master's degree, and kept rising quite vertically throughout your organizations and throughout your career path. And then all of a sudden, it's, wait a second, I'm now asked to be this inspiring and connected manager of people, or manager of product, or manager of client relationships. So as you see on the graph on the screen, right, there's actually an inflection point that's happening right now in your lives. So up to now, right, from kind of our Georgetown days into early career mode, we're in this very steep inflection curve of IQ, right? What is it that we know? What are the functional skills that we're building to basically command our craft, right, to become better and better at what we do functionally? And then we become known for that, right? Some of us become subject matter experts. Some of us, become client leaders in the things that we have basically, you know, grown our IQ around. Where you see the little green X on the screen, right, that's where we are at this next level of inflection curve. And we can continue on the dotted line path of IQ, and several people do, right? And there's going to be eventually a curve down of, you know, obviously from that graph, because you're not going to be growing as exponentially as you were earlier on in your career, right? You can still grow and learn, but it's not going to be as steep of a curve. Right now you have a choice, right, in this management role to take the next inflection curve of that career steep growth into this realm of emotional intelligence, EQ as we call it. Right, and so this is now about, hold on a second, it's not just what I know, it's how am I being around you? How do I make you feel when I am with you? Right, when we are operating through chaos professionally, when something happens in the organization, how am I grounding you? How do I help you feel anchored and at your best? That's the whole world of emotional intelligence. That's the stuff we're going to be thinking about today altogether. So jot down quickly, if you would, for me, on whatever piece of paper or space you have in front of you, how do you want to be known as a manager? So it could be a couple of adjectives, right? I wouldn't complicate it too much. 2-3 words, right? Do you want to be inspiring? Do you want to be driven? Do you want to be intellectual, right? Do you want to be nice? Do you want to be connected, right? What? Just jot down a couple of adjectives that come to mind. We don't do this, and people don't tell us to do this, and what happens is we try and start looking over our shoulders, right, of, wait, how should I be, or this person did that, so maybe I should do it a little bit like they did, or maybe there's another way that we can do that to replicate what happened over there, and the problem is we start becoming a chameleon, right? We start reacting to, okay, this is what the organization needs on Monday, I'll be that on Monday, and then I can be a little different on Tuesday, and then I'll do that on Wednesday. It's going to lead to exhaustion and burnout, right? So many of the folks that we coach, that's how we enter. They say, I can't, I'm stuck. Like, I love the work, I love the company, but I just, there's nothing left inside of me. So this is part of the antidote, something as simple as, what are the ways that you want to be known? Now, why does this matter? Because if you want to be known, let's say, as an inspiring and passionate manager, you all of a sudden simplify your solution set and your choices when you're up against something that you need to decide on or work through or present, right? If you want to be known as an intellectual and driven, your behaviors, your actions, the way in which you communicate and relate with your staff is going to be different than that person who wanted to be inspiring and passionate. So it gives you a bit of a lens, a bit of a funnel through which to make conscious decisions every single day. This is sort of one of the prime leadership tips that I can give you to get started on your journey, whether you just became a manager or you've been a manager for decades. All right. So there's two words that I think are fundamental, two concepts in our exploration of management, and particularly the mindset of management. And those words are trust and impact. Right. So trust is going to be all about, how do I take down my drawbridges, right? Because oftentimes when we're just a subject matter expert or that individual performer, we're on an island, right? It needs to be about us and what we own and how we present, right? And it just becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy that the island continues to be an island. Trust is all about, how do you still be that island, but now draw some bridges, right? Now draw some connection points between you and those that you lead, to be able to facilitate the communication, the impact, the ROI of your team, of your group, of your, you know, working group. So trust is how we're actually going to be able to feel differently and have those around us feel differently in terms of that connection and vulnerability, right? And the next concept is impact. So that's once we've built the trust, what is it that we do with it, right? That's a lot of what we're going to talk about in part two and part three of this series. So we're going to hone in a little bit on trust today. So trust is going to be, and this is based on the work of David Meister. He's done some incredible work on a book called The Trusted Advisor. For those of you who haven't read it, it's really a great read and a great something I have on my bookshelf all the time in terms of just fundamental concepts of how do you become better, right? Not as just a trusted, it doesn't have to be client advisor, a people advisor. How do you build trust? So four components that we're going to be looking at: credibility, reliability, intimacy, and self-orientation. So credibility, right, is do you know your stuff? That's the IQ. We can check that box off because you wouldn't be a manager if you didn't have the credibility. So this is the stuff that you know. Reliability, right, is going to be how kind of frequently and how consistently are you acting the way that you're acting. So every time about mindset today, right? So intimacy. Intimacy is all about how do we connect, right? How do we share vulnerability? How do we share stories about ourselves, right? So that you are able to see a different side of me and I'm able to shrink my blind spots. And by giving you feedback and you giving me feedback, all of a sudden we just have more of an arena, right, in which we can communicate, converse, connect. So credibility, reliability, intimacy, those are all going to be the components that build trust over time. So ask yourself, right, how am I doing in these three compartments? Now, there's a reason this is all divided by self-orientation. Self-orientation is going to be when I get in my head, right, rather than be present with you, I'm in my head wondering, ooh, will they like me? Ooh, how am I going to give them that difficult feedback? Oh, that's so tough. Let me just tell them that they're doing fine, or I'll wait till their annual performance review to tell them. That's self-orientation, because rather than serving the issue or the person at hand, we start worrying, right? That inner voice, that inner critic, for those of you who've joined me before, you know that this is the heart of the work, right? To really understand what is that mindset, what is that story that I am making myself uncomfortable in, that is actually standing in the way of building that trust and being the most effective leader I can. So there's a reason why it's in the denominator, because the higher that self-orientation and self-worry and self-criticism, right, and inner talk and inner gremlin, the higher that number, the more trust gets slashed. All right? So just keep in mind, and I know this sounds theoretical, I'm going to make it very practical for you in a second, but just keep in mind that this is how we are building trust, right? And we cannot talk about management at all. You know, we couldn't even start to approach management unless we're talking about trust-based relationships. So a couple of different things that we're going to look at. Today, mindset, next time, structure, and then skills of management, which is going to be building your entire toolkit. Now, for each of these dimensions, I want you to think and continue to think and be able to reflect with yourself. How does this impact you, right? So there's a me component, then there's a my team component, and then there's a my organization component. As individual contributors, we were typically only thinking about me, right? When's my next performance review? How can I do this job better, faster, more efficiently, more effectively, whatever. Now, your responsibility is trifold, right? So yes, it's the me. We got to put the oxygen mask on you first, and then always thinking, how is this impacting the members of my team? And finally, an entirely new stakeholder, right? How is this impacting the organization at large? How is my team impacting the organization? How are my actions, my behaviors, my leadership? So a couple of things that we're going to be looking at. So today we're going to talk about self-awareness, emotional intelligence, your time, your energy. Then when we talk move into structure, it's going to be much more practical, right, about roles, responsibilities, feedback, accountability, how to actually build the team, right, to its highest and best use. And then finally, it's going to be bringing it all together, right, with alignment, communication, what are those advanced skills, right, that are going to be necessary to pull that all together through trust and through impact. So emotional intelligence, I mentioned before that this inflection curve that you find yourself on is all about that. It's about your self-awareness, and by understanding yourself better, right, and shifting your mindset, being able to serve your people better. So that's what we're going to work through today. The quadrant that you see in front of you, right, is the basics of emotional intelligence, right? So there's the component on the top left quadrant, which is what I see, right, what I understand and acknowledge in my world with me, right? That's that self-knowledge. The bottom left hand, right, is what I see with others. So that's moving from self-awareness to real social awareness. On the top right, you're going to see, what do I do, right? So what are my actual behaviors with me? This is about self-management, self-orientation, self-leadership. How do I walk the talk? And in the bottom right quadrant, and we're going to go into detail on each of these in a moment, is relationship management. So how do I behave? How do I act? How do I align with others? These are the four non-negotiable, concurrent, essentially operational manual that goes on as a manager, which is very different than what had gone on as an individual contributor. When we can start building awareness and insight into each of these four quadrants, and you start building these muscles every day, that's the work. Right? Management is not going to happen with a snap of a finger between today and tomorrow. It's perpetual work, right? A couple of minutes a day to actually bring yourself back to center and say, wait a second, how did I do today on this? Am I tracking? How am I doing? What worked? What didn't work? Where are my gaps? Right? Where did I do really well? What do I want to continue doing in that meeting because it worked very well today? Right? It's going to be that five-minute check-in that I'm going to give you as a best practice tip, right, to be able to keep these things alive and move them from theory to practice. So let's start with self-awareness, that top left quadrant. This is your ability to accurately perceive your own emotions and stay aware of them as they happen. That's the magic phrase, as they happen. Because if they've happened already, then we've gone down the ripple effect, right, of our thought leading to an entire chain of reaction, which is our habitual thinking. It's our habitual patterns. Right? So this includes keeping on top of how you tend to respond to specific situations and people. This is about understanding everything from your self-talk, right, to your stress patterns, your default reactions, to be aware. This is all about consciousness building and awareness raising. That's the art of management. And I would argue a little bit of the science too. So our experience, and some of you have heard me share this before, but it's fundamental to our understanding of management mindset, is not like a camera. If it were like a camera, then we'd all be looking through the lens, seeing the same exact thing. The same things would bother us, the same things would excite us, the same things would bring us joy, and we know that that's not the case. Our experience is much more like a projector, right? So what we put into the darn thing is what's going to be projected out into our experience. So consider what the stories are that you tell yourself about yourself in that inner monologue, in that inner dialogue. So in coaching, we affectionately call this, right, is it your inner roommate? Is it your inner critic, your gremlin? You know what I'm talking about. It is those voices, a couple of examples on your screen from clients of ours. It is the voices in your head that do not serve you anymore. They may have served you in the past, right? It needs to be perfect. I need to drive. It's got to be harder. I've got to make more money. I've got to be better. Right? Those may have served you up to now. They are not going to serve you as a manager because the entire mindset and experience is different. It's like you just changed currencies. Individual contributor currency, you can get away with perfectionism. You can get away with, you know, with having some of these voices and having them just push you. It's not going to work in management because you are juggling so many people's mental stories and habitual thinking and stress responses that we need to keep you clear, present, focused. That's the magic of this. the more present and the more suspended your own agenda is, the more connected and impactful you're going to be as a manager. So this slide that you see in front of you, and I always joke, this is 6 months worth of executive coaching on one slide for you, so you're going to get your time's worth today on our webinar together. This is the foundation of how it works, right? So that one thought pattern that you have, right? Let's say I'm terrible at I'm a sucky manager, right? I'm no good at this. That thought pattern is going to lead to a feeling in your body, insecurity, self-doubt, worry, anxiety, disappointment. Now those chemicals of disappointment, anxiety, worry are pumping through your body because of that singular thought of I'm not good at this. From those chemicals pumping in your body, you are going to act a certain way or not act a certain way, right? So several of our clients, for example, they don't show up powerfully in meetings, or they will not be giving feedback in an active and timely fashion because they're uncomfortable, or they would rather just go dive into the work rather than being connected and being out and allowing their people to do the work because they feel they won't get the credit for it, right? So all of a sudden, all of our actions are shifting around this singular thought of I'm no good at this manager thing, right? So consider and keep these four words in your back pocket to see, wait a second, when you see yourself acting in a way that doesn't feel aligned, or when you're getting feedback from your team that you're not quite sure if that's really the best that you want to be performing as a manager, ask yourself, what's the thought pattern that's driving this? And more often than not, I promise you, it's going to be that deep, dark insecurity that we try and keep hidden, but is manifesting itself in your actions every day. So keeping awareness of this is going to be fundamental, right, to our self-awareness component of emotional intelligence. Without this acknowledgement, it's game over. Okay? So moving to our top right quadrant. Now we're talking about self-management. So now I know myself a little bit more. I know where I go. Right? I know my habitual thinking. I can identify the thought pattern. Now, how do I manage that? So this is your ability to use that awareness of your emotions to stay flexible and consciously direct your behavior. That's the magic bullet in this phrase, consciously direct your behavior. Because what normally happens is that thought, feeling, action, result, extrapolation, right? That's going to happen within seconds, if not milliseconds, in your brain, because it's so hardwired. Self-management is about consciously directing it, which means the art of choice, right? People always ask me, always, Valia, how do you define leadership, right? When you go in and you have a leadership development firm, well, tell me, well, when is that leadership thing happening? Fundamentally, and this to me is one of the greatest secrets of leadership, leadership happens in the moment right before you're going to react, when you're able to make a choice. And you can only make a choice, right, before that thought pattern happens, because then the ripple effect is so embedded in the grooves in your brain, right? This is all about neuroplasticity and neurolinguistic programming. So how do you take, right, how do you take that fundamental moment right before and you take a deep breath instead of reacting? How do you respond instead of react? That's the moment that leadership comes alive. Right? That's the moment where you chose consciously rather than from habitual unconscious. That's it. That's the magic of leadership. It happens in that moment. And when you have multiple moments of that in a given day, all of a sudden, you're leading your experience. You're managing your people to success. So this means choosing your emotional reactions to all situations and people. So how do we do that? First of all, you get to know yourself. Raw, honest, what the heck triggers you? Right? For me, one of them, if I am hungry and I am walking into a client meeting, it does not end well. So I know that I need to keep something as simple as this. I know I need to keep snacks in my bag because I'm not at my best if I don't feel nourished. Great. Ask yourself, what are your triggers? What are those stress reactions, those little points where you know your mood shifts or that person who gets under your skin, what is it about them? Right? Sit and really reflect on what is it that makes me tick in a good way and in a bad way, because that knowledge is 90% of the game. Once you know that, you're able to move right into consciousness because you get to choose that moment of leadership. Exactly what I was explaining before, right? That moment right before we go into that reaction, we learn to respond. The second thing around self-management that is the best tip that I can give you is asking yourself, how the heck are you managing your energy? Right? So energy, not time, is the fundamental currency of high performance. Performance, health, and happiness are grounded in the skillful management of energy. For those of you who haven't read this book, The Power of Full Engagement, it's fantastic. Another highly recommended leadership manager manual that I keep on my bookshelf. So quick sidebar on time versus energy, right? We think as a manager, oh yeah, I got to manage my time better. Yep, I got to manage it. Let me just try and control my time. Let me take out some meetings. Let me put in some new meetings. This is a recipe for burnout. And I know not a lot of people are going to tell you that. This is sort of the tough love coming from your coach. So I want you to figure out, how do you start managing for energy, not for time? Because time is a depleting resource. There's never going to be enough of it. We know that, right? So when you try and panic and, oh my gosh, now I have 10 people to manage or 3 people to manage and I have to meet with them weekly and that's a half an hour a week that I didn't have. So my day starts at 5 p.m. instead of starting at 10 a.m., right? We hear this all day long. And I don't want to say it's an excuse. It's a misdirected intention of trying to manage time versus energy. Energy can grow. All right? What fuels you, what drives you, what energizes you, what excites you is the stuff that we need to bring into how you manage. So that might be a 2-minute walk around the office. It might be a glass of water. It might be a couple of deep breaths as you're walking to the restroom rather than being on your cell phone. Right? It might be looking at a photo. It might be listening, reading a quote, right? Listening to a 1 minute of your favorite piece of music. Those little micro moments where you can connect back to you, what your brain is doing is zooming out 30,000 feet and forgetting about the work, but asking yourself, wait, why am I doing this work again? How am I doing it? What do I want to accomplish? How do I want to be known as a manager? It gives you a chance to zoom out, reconnect, recalibrate, and it does not take time. You can incorporate these things on the subway ride to work, on your drive to work, when you're walking your dog, right? Incorporate mindfulness practices and self-management practices in your day-to-day routine. That way it does not become an extra thing you have to add on. It becomes a more effective way to be doing that routine. And in doing so, the ripple effect is magical, because the ripple effect allows you to drop right back into the work and go from 30,000 feet right back down to sea level, to be more present, more conscious, more aware, more suspended with your agenda so you can be present for others. Okay, bottom left-hand quadrant of our emotional intelligence experience here, social awareness. So this is your ability to accurately pick up on emotions of other people, to get what's really going on underneath the surface, right? So this often means understanding what other people are thinking and feeling, even if you don't feel the same way. There's the magic bullet in this one. Even if you don't feel the same way. When you are an individual contributor, you are allowed to go off on thing and be mad at the manager and blame the boss and, you know, be frustrated with the colleague. You don't have that luxury anymore. And I won't even say luxury, because I think it's more of a fear-based model. You don't have the ability to hide behind anything because you're the one. The buck stops with you. Right? I do a lot of training with McKinsey folks who are moving from individual contributor to basically managing project teams for clients. And one of the biggest things that we work on, right, this is an entire week of training, one of the biggest things that we work on is stop pointing fingers, right? Well, I can't do this. Oh, the organization doesn't allow me. Well, that's not, you know, I can't because, no, there's not time, or that person's difficult, or everyone knows that that's the challenging boss or the challenging client. And with tough love, right, it's about understanding that that is no longer the option, because you are now the person who can be the change agent. You now have the responsibility, the accountability, and the broad awareness of various stakeholders that allows you to make that difference. So this is about moving from victim mindset, right, to empowered, conscious leadership mindset. It's about finding solution orientation rather than problem orientation. So, how you're listening, fundamental piece, non-negotiable piece, okay, of your management toolkit. And now, you're probably thinking to yourself, Valia, I'm a great listener. we all think we're great listeners, right? The problem is it's actually chemical and neurological, right? It's in the way we're wired. Our brain processes about 800 words a minute. But the problem is we speak about 200 words a minute. So by the time I'm speaking, you've already moved on, right, to something else that you're concerned about, to your next meeting, to what you want to have for lunch, right, to what you're doing for dinner tonight. It's human nature, which is why consciousness and mindfulness is becoming more and more vivid in business today. Because the impact is we disconnect. So I want you to consider just a way to look at listening, and I'm not going to go into this in too much detail because I want to leave plenty of time for questions. But a way to consider listening, here's the components. Number one is shifting your mindset. And what I mean by that is suspending your agenda. That does not mean you have to agree, disagree with the person in front of you, right, with your employee. It means that in that moment, you're looking to build alignment, right? You don't need to be agreeing, but you need to be listening from an objective 30,000-foot perspective with curiosity, huh? What's going on with this person right now with this challenge? What are they not seeing? How can I help them see what they're not seeing? Right? One of the best coaching tips I can give you is that the brain cannot be in judgment and curiosity at the same time. So where our natural inclination is to judge, to be frustrated, to feel like, why is this taking so long? Why haven't they given me what I told them for the 10th time? Instead of your brain going there, how do you get curious? And instantly, you're going to feel a chemical shift in your body. Because curiosity is, huh, that's so weird. Three times that guy, John, has showed up to the meeting late. What's going on there? I got to figure it out. You go to a completely different part and access much more intuitive wisdom and social awareness when you go to curiosity. So shifting your mindset. Asking effective questions. Right? This is so much of the work that we do. As we coach our clients and as we train people, what are the questions you're asking? Because changing the type of question is going to change the answer that you get from people. So make sure your questions are open-ended. Make sure they're future-focused, right? Make sure they're counterintuitive. Hey, what haven't we tried? Help their brains start seeing solution rather than problem. That's one of the best tips I can give you to enhance your management starting this afternoon. All right, what we tend to do is we stack questions, right? We get uncomfortable, so we ask a million questions, and then the person doesn't know how to respond. Or we ask closed-ended questions. We put our recommendations. Well, haven't you tried doing X, Y, and Z? Question mark, right? That's not an open-ended question. That's a statement very beautifully decorated with a question mark at the end. All right. Language, intuition, what patterns have you seen that are actually counterintuitive to what this person is saying, right? Where are you thinking, they're saying they're fine, but something is not right. I need to actually address that spot on. And we'll talk more about that in part two of our series. And finally, summarizing and checking in, right? How do you make sure that you are talking about the same thing? By stopping and saying, let me just make sure I understood you. Hold on, time out 1 second. Are we on the same page? I'm hearing X, Y, and Z. Is that right? It gives them a chance to be heard and really feel listened to, and it gives you a chance to make sure that you're tracking. This is the most fundamental manager skill and one that you can teach your people so that you have an evolved dialogue around what needs to be going on. I'm going to skip through a couple of these for the sake of time and for your questions. So the bottom right quadrant, right, relationship management. So this is the final of the four, critically important. Right? This is your ability to use the awareness of your emotions and the emotions of others, all the hard work we've done up to now, to lead interactions successfully, right? Consciously. This includes clear communication and effectively handling conflict. This is going to be the main area of focus for part three of our session early next year. So I'm not going to go into too much detail, just a couple of highlights. And then, Sarah, I'm going to turn it to you so we can open up for some questions. So one thing that I want to share with you in terms of this relationship management, the difference between sympathy and empathy, right? This sounds like, okay, Valia, thanks for the nuance. It's not, right? Sympathy is about, ooh, I feel so bad for this person. Ooh, I feel so uncomfortable. It goes back to that self-orientation that I was telling you about that erodes trust. Not that sympathy isn't appropriate. Sympathy is appropriate, right, in certain instances where you really just want to feel bad and sorry with the person. Empathy is the manager skill. Empathy is about, I understand the situation, or even if I don't, I can see that you are having an experience, and I am going to hold space for you to have that experience. I'm going to give you feedback, or I'm going to continuously ask you so that we stay open about this, so that we stay vulnerable about this. So empathy is not diving in. Sympathy is diving in. Sympathy leads to that self-orientation of, ooh, I'm so uncomfortable. How do I even say that? Empathy is, I need to say that in service to this relationship, in service to this program, in service to this organization. Remember, you're always asking yourself, what's here for me, what's here for my team, and what's here for my organization? Sympathy to empathy is shifting also from individual contributor to manager. Vulnerability. I mean, we could do a whole talk on vulnerability. For those of you who haven't watched, please watch Brené Brown's TED Talk, The Power of Vulnerability. It's Brené, B-R-E-N-E, Brown. Fantastic insight to management in a way that is very counterintuitive, right? How do we show more of ourselves rather than try and say, oh, I'm the boss now, I can't really share that, or I need to be more quote-unquote professional, right? It's about humanizing your experience and, yes, staying professional and confident and poised, but being able to share more of you. And in doing so, allowing other people to share more of themselves. So let's I'm gonna blow through a couple more. A couple of final tips, and then Sarah, I'm going to open it up to you. A couple of more tips for your mindset piece of your manager toolkit. One is try setting goals in terms of the word of the month or the word of the year. This has changed my work completely. So rather than saying these are the 40 things I need to complete this month, try going back to one of your words of how you want to be known as a manager. I want to be known as passionate. Great. So if that's the case, say that for the month of November, my word is passion. And you will go through your behaviors every single day and say, huh, how could I bring more passion into this right now? If I was really driving by passion, what's the one thing I would do to this employee? How would I interact with them? What question would I ask them? It becomes your compass. It becomes your North Star. And it allows so much more clarity and focus when you're worrying about that managing time versus energy. The other thing I would recommend, this second bullet, create rituals for yourself. Create some trigger, just like I said, let's say every time you walk your dog is the trigger, and then create a habit. Create that habit of deep breathing, of mindfulness, right, of being able to center yourself, to zoom out to that 30,000 foot spot to ask yourself, how am I doing? That check-in muscle is the most important thing that I can share with you on today's call of what distinguishes amazing managers from managers who just functionally lead other people. All right, we talked about managing energy versus time, we talked about vulnerability, and we talked about getting to know your default stress patterns and stress reactions. So why don't we, and I love this quote, and we'll end with that and turn it to Sarah, that each person holds so much power within themselves that needs to be let out. Sometimes they just need a little nudge, a little direction, a little support, and a little coaching, and the greatest things can happen. And to me, there is no more incredible role than being a manager. I feel like it is a gift, it is a privilege, and it is a really big responsibility. And today was, I hope for all of you, a bit of getting out of our own way to just see how can I create checkpoints with myself to better serve my people. So Sarah, why don't we get a whole bunch of questions, and then I'll tell everyone at the end about the rest of our series.
All right, wonderful. Thank you so much, Valia. I know a lot of people here, a lot of this information is resonating with them, so thank you. And first question, as a manager, how can you go about identifying your blind spots?
Such a good question. Thank you. So the first and foremost thing, and I don't know if you're going to like that I'm going to say this, is we need to get really clear on how we're asking for feedback. Because very likely, because you were an individual contributor and a rock star and got to where you are, people kept saying, you're doing great, you're doing great. Yep, now you're going to manage people. The best way to know your blind spots is go to a couple of trusted people and say very specifically, very targeted, what are the one or two things that if I were to do differently would make me that much more effective? That targeted question allows you, A, to get feedback, but it allows them to not just say wonderful things, it allows them to give you that piece of advice that maybe they wouldn't feel comfortable saying if it's truly a blind spot, but would say it because it's coming from a place of your development. So I would poll, what I have my clients do and what we have our clients do at Paradox, is poll 5-10 people in your trusted circle, old bosses, colleagues, different stakeholders, people that report into you, and say, you know what, I'm doing a little bit of kind of development for myself as a manager. I'd love to know what are the one or two things that I could do that would either serve you, serve the organization, or help me be better at what I'm doing. That's it. It's an incredibly powerful but very targeted tool, and quite frankly, you can get that done in a day or two time. And people feel really honored and happy to oftentimes to be asked to be part of it. So that would be kind of my very practical and first line of defense that I would recommend.
All right. I really love this question. What if how you want to be seen as a manager is different from your natural personality? For example, if you want to be viewed as motivating, ethical, and passionate, but your natural self is a driven perfectionist.
So powerful. So fantastic question. So here's the tough love. And we see this all the time as coaches. We try and say, all right, well, this is my personal self all the way out to the right, and here's my professional self all the way out to the left. You can do that. It will get exhausting over time. So the magic word in this work of management and leadership is, how do you start integrating? All right, so if you are driven perfectionist, right, first I want you to walk through that thought, feeling, action, result model and ask yourself, right, is it coming from a fear-based place that I'm a driven perfectionist, or is it coming from an empowered place? For me, I also can completely agree and self-select into that bucket of driven perfectionist before a lot of the work that I've done on myself, right? Is it coming from fear? For me, it was. I come from Greek immigrant parents, and the fear was, if we don't work hard and if it's not perfect, then there's not going to be a job, then there's not going to be money, then we're going to live in a box, right? It goes very quickly down to this crazy place because it was not my vision for me. It was what I had taken on as the way of survival, right? The way of being the quote-unquote good girl, the way of being able to make other people happy. So the first thing I want you to do is catch yourself. Is the perfectionist and the driven perfectionist still serving you today? If it's not serving you, then you want to be thinking about those other words, right, of passionate, of motivated. And the simple way to start shifting behavior, because I know this is tough, right, I'm making it sound easy, this is tough, the simplest way to start shifting behavior is incorporating that word of the month. So let's say today, for this month or for this week, your word is motivating. I want to be motivating to my people. Great. So as you go about your day, starting this afternoon, catch yourself. Just notice what you're doing habitually and say, is this inspiring and motivating for my people? Yes, no question. That's the one time I'll ask you to, I'll let you make yes, no question. It's to do a quick check-in with yourself. Is this motivating? If the answer is yes, keep doing it. If the answer is no, how can I incorporate more motivation or more passion, right? Whatever the word is that you want to choose. That will help your brain start seeing that there's other ways of creating impact rather than the habitual thinking of that perfectionism. I hope that helps.
All right. And how do you balance management situations when you are at an organization, for instance, this person's at a medical practice, where you need to do task-specific functions that are critical to the organization as well as be a manager?
Yes. This is the fundamental thing, right? This goes right back to the time and energy because you have a day job too, right? You need to do the tasks. You need to have your deliverables on time, right, and the way that you want to deliver them while managing people. So here's a couple of thoughts. One is ask yourself quite honestly, how much of my time, right? One of the exercises we always have our clients do is to create a time map, right? So create a pie chart. Where are the chunks of your time going? Right? It's 40% is my tasks, 20% is in meetings, and 10% might be managing my people, whatever it is, right? So map out in big, broad chunks your time map. From there, I just want you to look and give an honest assessment. Is that the right percentage of time that you want to be giving to your staff? If it's 10%, fine. I think that's probably a little low. It's kind of a best practice. It's about 30% to 40% is going to be, when you're a manager, is going to be in meetings and in development conversations with your people. So ask yourself, what are the things that I can do to shift from that 10% to that 30%, right, without it having to feel like, oh my gosh, I'm overwhelmed, now I'm going to take all my time. It's not all your time. It's about making better choices and making sure that each of the things that you're doing in a given day falls into one of those buckets. That's kind of the first tip that I can give you, is recalibrate the actual engagement of time. The second thing I would say is, how are you using your time with your people? Oftentimes when it feels overwhelming, it's because we're either having way too many one-on-one meetings, or we're not integrating the right people, or there's not focus in those meetings. I have had people and coached clients to do 5-minute stand-up meetings where they ask their direct reports three things: what's working, what's not, and where are the gaps that you need my help on, right? So you can create new rhythms and new ways rather than having to have 1 hour. You can save the 1 hour development chat with a person as a monthly meeting, and then have weekly, right, check-in, 15-minute stand-up meetings, 20-minute stand-up meetings. The other thing that I find that's a bit of a rabbit hole that we don't do as new managers, what are they accountable for to bring to that meeting to make it more effective, which will be less of a drain on your time? If you're feeling like you're carrying all the weight of that meeting, you're carrying too much. So do they need to prepare an agenda? Do they need to email you in advance if you prefer that? Do they need to come up with the top three hot topics and nothing more? So that all depends on your preference. So the prelude to all of this is, you need to sit down with yourself, go out for lunch with yourself and have a coffee, and sit down and map out, as a manager, how do I want my people interacting with me? What is my best case scenario? What are my rules of engagement? How do I want them to communicate with me? Right? Once you've mapped this out, step two is the education. To let people know, whether it's an existing team or as you're onboarding new people, hey, here's how we work. Here's a couple of rules of engagement. Here's how our meetings run. Here's what I'd like you to prepare for the meetings. Right? Here's how I'm going to be giving you feedback, right, so that we start normalizing feedback. Once all of these become normal, new, but consciously decided by you, processes and procedures, you are going to feel much less split between task orientation and management orientation.
All right, wonderful. And some of the work managers are required to do include sharing information that's negative. So how do you balance what type of manager you want to be with dealing with those difficult conversations and situations?
Yeah, super question. So I would say the most important thing that we have to do as managers is to be giving that difficult feedback. And we're going to talk a lot about this next month on November 15th. So my two cents on that is, this is a mindset shift. I want you to ask yourself, by not giving that difficult feedback to the person, are you helping or hurting them? Because oftentimes, by not sharing where they're standing in their own way or where they keep stumbling and feeling uncomfortable, you are actually depleting the relationship over time. You are not serving that person. And so if your word was, I want to be motivating and inspiring and passionate, and you're telling me that you're not going to give difficult feedback, I would say you're actually not going to be motivating, inspiring, and passionate. Have that we can't hide behind that. So ask yourself, in service to the relationship, would giving this difficult feedback help in a short and long term? And 99% of the time, it's absolutely yes. So when you can shift that mindset and say that this is in service to the relationship, right, not to hurt it, it will instantly put your guard down, make you feel that much more present, and again, in service to something bigger, which will automatically connect to those three words that you want to be known for, right? Engaging, inspiring, whatever it is. So best tip I can give you is do that little mental mindset trick. What is this feedback? Is it necessary? And if so, I'm guessing it's necessary, right? If so, is it in service to this person for their longer term growth and development? And almost always the answer is yes. And if it's not, if the answer is no, it might be a piece of feedback that's actually not relevant or that can wait until a broader review or that's not worth making an entire conversation around. And sometimes that happens. I hope that helps.
Okay. I know this happens to many managers. I struggle sometimes with taking on work that I should delegate because I'm worried about the workload on staff, or I would also add in, you can be worried about the quality of the work and if it's not in your own style. So what's a good way to deal with that challenge?
Yes, that, I mean, isn't that the challenge, right? And that does not get easier, I think, with time. I think even as we grow as to be leaders of organizations, then we're having to, you know, delegate to our leaders of leaders, and that's challenging as well. So the best thing that I can share from my experience with clients and what I've seen work for them is being more involved earlier in the process. And I know that sounds obvious, but we don't do it. We think delegation, okay, let me give them space. If you can articulate why you want what you want, right, your vision for it, and then what, when a deliverable is due, like actually give some scaffolding and a framework, then you've done your part. At that point, it's up to the person, right, assuming you trust them and you're going to delegate to them, it's up to that person to fill in the sandbox, right? You've given them the scaffolding. You've said you can do this within these four walls, right? You need to give them some space at that point to play with whatever is right in front of them. From there, how do you have frequent and often check-ins? And again, this goes back to the earlier question of rules of engagement. How are you educating people to communicate back to you? So if you want a weekly email, hey, here's the project status, here's the update, fine, whatever you want. If you'd rather wait till the end, if you'd rather do two check-ins, it doesn't matter, but you need to be dictating that. Your biggest responsibility as a manager is be ruthless with the process. Once you're ruthless with the process, allow for creativity, allow for individualization to come in within the process, and then you have frequent check-ins. That's going to make you feel much more at ease, and it's also going to make the work feel authentically theirs. And let's be honest, one of the biggest things that we see in terms of, well, what I find in terms of incredible leadership is you notice, right, it's so seamless. The staff is doing so well that everyone knows it's because you are the driving force and you are that silent leader leading from behind, but that they are getting the acknowledgement and recognition. But of course, the ripple effect is they wouldn't be getting that acknowledgement and recognition were it not for you. So there's a bit of a mindset shift of realizing the power of leading from behind. And then there's also the functional part of be really ruthless with the process early and often. And I think those two things together will really combine to make you feel much more grounded in that comfort and discomfort of delegation.
All right. And how do you deal, what technique do you do to rein in impatience as you lead or guide as opposed to instruct? We have someone here who jokes that they always have this mental dialogue, like, I know you're smart, so why can't you do this? So how do you do it?
Such a good question. And isn't it what we're always thinking? That's such a great question. So patience is a tricky one, and I have not mastered the art of patience. So this is what I've seen other people do and do successfully. It goes back to that judgment versus curiosity. That's the one tool that I've given clients, and then when they practice it, they say, wow, I was that much more relaxed because I wasn't irritated or I wasn't feeling impatient. When you feel like you want to wring that person's neck and shake them, right, go into curiosity and actually, you know, just say to yourself, what could be going on with this person that they're not delivering, right? Okay, I know they're smart. I get that. What am I not seeing? Ask yourself, turn inward to those open-ended questions and have a dialogue, and some insight is going to come or something you haven't thought about to either be able to address explicitly or, more importantly, it just calms you down because impatience is down the judgment track. Curiosity is going to feel much more open, calming, just connected to that person and how to help them succeed versus wanting to to wring their neck. But that's a great question.
All right, and we have, I know we're at time, so we have some other great questions. I will make sure to send them to Valia so that she can see them and respond later. But Valia, I know you had some information you want to share before we get off the line.
Sure, sure, and thanks to all of you for sticking till the very end. I just wanted to tell you a bit about the rest of the series so that you can connect with us and also share with you our website and email address so you can send any questions. My team and I, we're happy, we're here. We really want to make this a very practical and functional experience for you. So today, obviously, we talked about mindset. November 15th, it is my sincere pleasure to welcome one of the lead coaches on my team, Kathy McConnell, who more importantly is a Hoya alumni. So she is thrilled to be leading us on November 15th. And this is going to be all about the skills and structure of managing a team. So everything from how to actually build people a little more on that time and energy, giving feedback, receiving feedback, how to structure effective meetings. So really kind of bring your pen and paper to that one, because we're going to talk about structural best practices to getting the most out of the team from a strength-based leadership perspective. And on February 25th, another beautiful member of my team, Kara Power, she is going to be talking all about communication and management toolkit. So this is now going to take all the structure and mindset that we've built this quarter and then build it out for you guys in terms of navigating difficult conversations, figuring out your audience and how to adjust a message, storytelling, right? So really kind of the 360 art of management in the realm of communication. And Kathy and Kara have been working with me for a very long time, incredible coaches on the team who the three of us serve. The majority of our clients across industry. So it's just my sincere pleasure to welcome them to get to meet all of you and to really build your experience with us as Paradox. And finally, we're going to close the final session, which will probably be all three of us on the phone, to help train you on actual coaching skills. So moving beyond management and feedback to coaching and to give you some of our best practices, simple tips and tricks to get the most out of people when you want to develop them for the long term, and then have it be a full open mic Q&A session. So we'll probably do about 20 minutes of training and then open up the rest of the time to your questions. So in closing, let me leave you with our website, theparadoxofleadership.com. You have my email there, valia@theparadoxofleadership.com, and the team and I will get back to you with any questions you have and any way we can support you moving forward, whether it's personal coaching for your organizations. We're here to help. So thank you all for being here today. And Sarah, back to you.
All right, wonderful, Valia. Thank you so much for sharing this great expertise. I do just want to clear up, if you can go back to the webinar dates, November 15th is not when Kathy's webinar is happening. It's November 17th.
Oh, so, goodness. Sorry.
November 17th, no problem. And that's on, if you click on the registration link that I've sent out in the chat area, and we'll send out as well in the follow-up email, you will be able to register, and you'll see that date, Tuesday, November